The Boruto manga just introduced a absolute game changer to the story, to the franchise as a whole, with Ada, one of the latest recruits to the Kara group under Code's tutelage, although I don't know how far I'd go by saying under Code, but either way, Ada is about to be a major game changer. And one of the things that I gotta commend Boruto for is that, don't get me wrong, there's a bunch of stuff that I praised with the last arc in particular, but I also like when Boruto is capable of bringing stuff to the table that isn't just a branch off of, or you know, taking and expounding on things from the Narutoverse, and actually creating and bringing forth things of its own. Because the whole reveal of who Ada is, and there's so much to, you know, dive into, we're gonna talk about it with this chapter 57 of Boruto. There's just so many things you could say that it's going to do for the story and where things is going to move forward. I could definitely see where there's going to be a lot of people hating, saying this, that, and the third regarding Ada's powers, because yes, very, very hacks with some of her capabilities. But nevertheless, I feel as though Ada is definitely one of the most interesting things that the Boruto series has added in a long time, that is seemingly straight up just from the Borutoverse. It's not like, you know, something, oh, you know, this is a character from Naruto, like a Ao, or, you know, the Otsutsuki with Ishiki. Ada is strictly a Boruto thought idea, and so far from what I've seen with this chapter, she seems like she's going to be incredible moving forward with the Boruto story. But yeah, again, we got lots to talk about, from Code, his desires, Boruto and Kawaki, the Gokage Zoom meeting, and just a lot of stuff. So without further ado, people, let's talk a little bit of that Boruto manga Great Walls. Let the android saga Boruto commence. No matter how you feel, so majority of Boruto chapter 57 definitely was diving into Code and him moving forward and progressing and basically building up his army, because after the whole defeat of Ishiki Otsutsuki and things like that, I was left with the thought of, well, how much of a threat is Code going to be? Even after we started little by little, which seems as though we've been having setup chapter after setup chapter the last couple of months in a row, which is good because we need it. But it was like, okay, Code, even with his limiter thing that was introduced in the last chapter, how much, you know, what is he really going to be? And then when we get this chapter, the introduction of Ada and all the lore that was brought forth with her, this is where I'm like, okay, I can see this being a competent challenge. On top of the fact that Naruto no longer has Kurama, Sasuke is one-eyed now, so it's definitely looking like little by little there's a threat being formed here. But the chapter kicks off initially with Code and Bugs speaking about various different things, like for starters that Code wasn't 100% certain of Boro's betrayal of, like, you know, holding this android, so to speak, with Ada and all that stuff. Like, he had his suspicions, but he wasn't 100% confirmed. And this right here, the very next line we're about to talk about, is where already I'm wondering, there's something more there regarding Code and his capabilities. Because following that, he said he didn't want to tell Jigen because then he'd have to take out Boro, and he didn't have the heart to take out a good-natured buddy. How much of that is actually there? Like, we've seen that Code has some sort of attachment to Ishiki, right? He has some love for him, or a lot of love and worshiping and all that stuff. But did he really have that for Boro, or was there something more to it? Was it possibly like some sort of program code that Amado code, huh? That Amado set forth within Code, that like you can't attack your fellow comrades, or what was it exactly? Because that just kind of seemed a little out of character. Like, I couldn't attack a good-natured fella like him, fam. I don't know. You were loyal to Kara, but you were more so loyal to Ishiki, if anything, and not necessarily the other ones. Especially the fact that you were straight up worshiping Ishiki, for you to be like, I can't do it, it's either a little bit messy there, or it's because Boro is basically something that he couldn't have attacked or couldn't have went after due to whatever the circumstances is with his body. But Bug continues to warn Code, like, yo, Ada's not gonna listen to you by brute force, fam. You could try all you want, it's not gonna happen. But he's like, got this. And of course he uses his karma mark to turn his claws out and basically rip open the container that that she's in, and honestly, it was just straight up so many Android Saga vibes, so many things like that, which I feel like, to a certain degree now, like, think about it, Ada is what potentially they were initially going for with Delta. Like, that's something that's starting to kind of set in for me, that initially, I'll never forget, when we started all this way back, like, 2 or 3 years ago with this arc, I really thought, like, oh, shoot, this is really going the Android direction. Shortly into it, it kind of started deviating from that and went a different direction and more so focusing on the Otsutsuki. Now that we're circling back to this initial premise of the androids and things like that, and the fact that Ada's character design just looks a lot different than like 18 Android 18 from Dragon Ball Z, that's what initially I thought was going to happen with Delta. The way things are being handled right now with Ada is what I thought was going to go down with Delta, a lot of these variables. So to see it actually coming full circle into this whole android motif and moving forward, like, even, you know, when they're breaking through the container, things like that, I'm like, this was probably the initial idea and conception of where we were going, and something, whether it be poor sales or whatever it was, maybe Ukyo Kodachi's ideas like morphed, like went a different direction, but this is probably what we were supposed to get at first. I mean, because if you even think about it, like, there's way more detail with this, like with Delta and them, it was kind of glossed over. It was like, yeah, we know a little bit, yeah, she don't like Amado and things like that. This is actually going straight into a lot of the lore of these characters, and also a lot of build-ups and setups for relationships between them. But then we cut to the Gokage Zoom meeting, which, fam, over on Twitter, I had posted a joke about this. It was a lighthearted joke, no ill intent, I just genuinely found it a little humorous that, oh shoot, they doing like Zoom, you know, they in lockdown over there, Naruto world couldn't escape what we're going through over here. But I was just lightheartedly joking about it. A lot of people took it serious and they were like, oh no, they've been doing this since the Shippuden days, look at the last. Well, first of all, there was a little bit of a difference. For starters, the last and the Shippuden conferences that they were doing were like multiple screens and things like that. This was one screen with four, like, you know, Zoom style. That's the difference. And overall, it was just a joke because it's genuinely, you know, mirroring what happens on a Zoom call. Like, that was the whole point of my joke. Oh, if you follow me on Twitter, it was a joke. It definitely is mirroring Zoom. I'm aware that the Narutoverse has had technology and all of these things for quite some time. Even if you go back to original Naruto, they were using headsets. So it was kind of like, think of it like Dragon Ball Z. Like Dragon Ball Z, you'll have capsules and then you'll have dinosaurs, you know? That's kind of in the Narutoverse. It kind of feels like olden times, but then they had headsets, and then now we've evolved immensely to the point where we're using, you know, artificial jutsu. And they drop a few small gems that you would kind of assume, like, okay, the Kara base is in a different dimension, and Code made sure to cover his tracks of, like, he destroyed any possible ways over there. So makes me wonder exactly how is Code getting back and forth between the Kara dimensions. And then some jargon that we kind of already know of, like, you know, Code's motives of what we know thus far of, hey, he wants to kill Naruto and them for, you know, revenge against Ishiki, and he wants to cultivate a Ten Tail. So that was some information that, of course, the Gokage need to know these things, but I feel like, I think they handled it nice, actually. I was about to say, like, oh, we didn't need it. Well, yeah, they need that info, and at the very least, we needed to know that they were informed on all of it, and it was only a page, so I'm not going to fault them for that. But shout-outs to the Raikage. He immediately deduces, like, wait a minute, yo, this dude, Amado, sounding a little fishy. What's going on over here? You trust him, fam? Like, what's the deal? It's always shout-outs to the Raikage with the deductions immediately, whether it was A, the former, like, they always are on top, on point, and Darui is no exception. He's like, yo, what? And I'm glad that Naruto admitted that even he doesn't 100% trust Amado. Like, yeah, Amado has helped out. Yeah, things have happened. And then I also like the fact that the Tsuchikage threw in, wait a minute, you know, like, that could have been a horse and pony show. Basically, everything we've seen up until this point, which is what I've been thinking, could have just been a farce. Whether Ishiki was in on it or not, could have been Amado's farce of, like, he thought and deduced all these things. Because remember, Amado's a really smart guy. Like, he's just arguably more advanced than Orochimaru, you could say. So, yeah, he could have deduced and planned everything up until this point of what happened to Ishiki. It could have been a horse and pony show a la what the Tsuchikage said. Or I think it was a dog and pony show. You know what I mean. And the Gaara line to Naruto brought me back a little bit. Gaara always looks at, like, you know, the hard decisions. Like, you know, you go back to when he faced Sasuke and all that stuff. Like, I love that line. Probably a lot of people didn't get as impacted with it as I did. But I love when Gaara face Naruto and say, yo, the truth is, there's a hard decision coming, and I want to know, are you capable of doing it? Like, Boruto is being possessed little by little. If he turns into Momoshiki, are you capable of putting him down, your own son? And Naruto's response following that, his follow-up, kind of contradicted one another, because he's like, yo, I'll do my duties as a Hokage. It is what it is. Then he afterwards says, I've already talked to Sasuke, and Sasuke said he'll do it. No, motherfucker. You're like, no. You're his father. You're the Hokage. Like, if anything, it should definitely be the dad to put him down. I get it, the whole sensei thing, but when he said that, for a moment, I did feel like, yo, you're kind of escaping a little bit of accountability. That is your son. I get it. He's, you know, probably Boruto would prefer Sasuke to put him down anyway, but that was just a little bit awkward, I guess you could say, of like him saying, yo, I'm a Hokage, I'll do what I gotta do, but I spoke to Sasuke and he said he'll do it. I mean, granted, who the hell in that situation, like, even throughout the chapter you could feel it, just, you know, the things Naruto was saying, like, who wants to even think about that? Like, he's like, at a certain point, I don't even want to believe this is happening to my own son. So I get it, I understand why you would be like, yeah, Sasuke, but just kind of conflicted line to line of what he was saying. And here's where we start getting big bombshells, and, you know, we'll talk about it throughout the video, but Amado says, nah, I get what you're going through, fam. I had a daughter once too, and he goes on to say it's been like 12 years now, she died. I'm clearly, and I think most people are going with the idea that, hey, Ada gets introduced in this chapter and he talks about having a daughter that's been dead for 12 years. Ada is a cyborg, so to speak. That's his daughter. It seems very obvious, and I would love if we were actually duped and bamboozled and that's not his daughter and it's something totally different, but it's leading me down a pathway of thinking of, well, okay, that's his daughter. And if she supposedly died 12 years ago and he made a cyborg, either he just recreated her because, like, you know, he got sick and was like, man, I miss my daughter. So there's a possibility there. Or Amado has done everything up until this point, working with Ishiki and everything, to potentially save his daughter. Maybe she died, she was supposed to die, and he did all these things working with Ishiki and whatnot to heal his daughter at some given point, and that's still the whole goal. Maybe Ada, the reason why she was sleeping, and even later in the chapter she says, like, I've been asleep for a while, is because she needs to be in captivity and encased in something in order to live on, because if not, she'll die. Maybe, like, she's only partially cyborg, but she's still human and possibly still dying. That's wild thinking into the future of everything with Amado and his motives, but that could also be the case. It could be that he's not a mustache twirling evil guy. He's just somebody that's doing anything possible to keep his daughter alive or save his daughter. Or again, it could just be like this is an homage to his deceased daughter that died 12 years ago, what she would have looked like as an adult. And then Amado starts slinging them Caesar clowns, One Piece reference. Basically, he's like, yo, fam, I got this on the low if you want. But basically, he's come up with a concoction that essentially can weaken the Byakugan, and he's hoping that since the Otsutsuki are, you know, linked closely to the Byakugan, it could slow down the Momoshiki possession. I could think of a couple of different things of, like, who knows, maybe he's lying, maybe it's not going to slow it down, maybe it's going to speed it up, maybe he needs an Otsutsuki and wants to work with an Otsutsuki so that he could possibly save his daughter, and then if his daughter is almighty powerful like we've seen Ada to seemingly be, then he could put down the Otsutsuki. But again, I'm thinking way ahead. I keep on fusing theories and predictions with, you know, my analysis of what's going on right now. But he says that there's some side effects to this concoction, one of which being that, you know, sight decrease, basically his vision could get bad, but also death is a possibility. And you just gotta imagine, this is really hard on Naruto. So my son is being possessed, I gotta give him these drugs that essentially could kill him. Like, Naruto's going through it. And when he said that line, the extra line of, I don't gotta tell you, but make sure your daughter and your wife don't take them, obviously, because, you know, they're Hyuga, they have Byakugan as well, it made me just wonder, like, is it really what he's saying it's to be? Or is it, again, he don't want to deal with three superpowered, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's just something there that it makes me, you know, at the end of the day, we don't trust Amado. Like, even Naruto don't trust him. Like, there's something there. So that was just like, he could very well just be saying, hey, don't have them take it because it's going to weaken them and they could die, whatever. Could be something else. But the fabulous and graceful Ada comes out of the case and walks right by Code, basically dubbing him, making him look like a fool. And I was like, from the time she comes out of that capsule, I'm calling it now, Ada is going to be huge when she makes it to the anime. She's already huge. I've seen nonstop talk and chatter all over about Ada. When she makes it to the anime, she's going to be huger because, bam, the design, amazing. The color page of her alone, I forgot to talk about the color page, looked absolutely gorgeous. Like, the coloring, I can't get enough of how they did the colors for her. Obviously, in black and white, you don't get the same, but, like, her design, she looks great. Like, not even on, no, oh my god, she's gorgeous. Like, I'm talking about just strictly, like, artistically, I love what they did with her. This is what, I feel like they were trying to go for with Delta, but you also got to remember that the Boruto manga at that point, they were still sharpening their knife, so to speak. They were still getting it together on how, you know, to draw and stuff like that. The artist, you know, was still figuring out how to do this art style. I think Ada is a more perfected idea from the mangaka of, or, you know, the writer and artist of what Delta was supposed to be. And here's something else that was tricky, right? Because it could be that she just came out of the case, or there's a buffer in between the time that her ability goes off, because Code was able to, for a split second, stab through her. Like, you see, it looks like his claw went through her for a moment, and then all of a sudden she looks, and bam, Code goes from, he stabs her to, I can't do nothing. So I'm wondering what that was about. Was it, again, it took a little second for the effect to take place. She gotta look a certain way. She gotta look right at you. Maybe when she came out the case, she didn't look at him for a second and then walked right past without looking. Because we got to remember, down the road of this chapter, we'll talk. Also, Code was in the same circumstances and predicament as Kawaki. Like, he has the white coma mark, but nevertheless, he had Otsutsuki go through him. So it could very well be that he has some sort of Otsutsuki within him. And basically, that's why for a split second, he was able to attack her and then was frozen. Because, like, he doesn't have enough to strictly bypass it, but he has enough that he could disobey if need be for maybe a moment. And Code, because he's feeling salty, he's like, I bet you don't want to show me no love. That's straight, yo. I'm going to dispose of you. Yeah. And she's like, try it. Bet. Try it. Go ahead. And then I love the follow-up line when she's like, yo, truth be told, I wasn't trying to be an ass. You know, I just woke up, man. I got bad breath, fam. I was like, this is an interesting young lady right here. And I love how right after that, even though obviously we get, you know, the explanation, whatnot, Code just like, looked like he fell in love. Like, oh my God, she got bad breath. That is so hot. Like, Code, goddamn, boy, you down horrendous right now. And Bug basically explains to Code about her ability. Like, yo, fam, like, no, you got your heart stolen. Like, you're not in love with her. It's not like, you know, because Code is there acting young, to be honest with you. Like, oh man, she's so awesome. Like, no, she got you by the balls, fam. And that also explains why he wasn't able to attack her. Although, again, I think there's a little bit more to it, because, again, he attacked her for a moment and then it was over. Like, what's up with that? Or was that something that later on she says? Because remember, later on in the chapter, she tells Code, hey, I knew you was going to come to me. Again, she supposedly can't see the future, but she knew that Code was going to come. What if what we actually saw go through her wasn't actually, like, it didn't occur? It was that she does have some sort of foresight and she lied. Just the thought there. Like, yo, fam, we covering all bases with this video. Shout outs to me. And Ada describes her clairvoyance, basically her other ability, as something where, imagine cameras all over the world and you're able to see through these cameras all over the world, but it does get boring. Like, I don't know, if I had cameras all over the world, I don't think I'd be bored. I'd be like, yo, what's Beyonce doing? Bet. Yo, Rihanna, oh my God, Riri. I don't think I'd be bored, Ada, but hey, you know, I don't know how long you've been around. Because that's another thing, like, how long has she been alive? I mean, if we're connecting it to the whole idea that was set up with Amado, could be that she's at the very least been around over 12 years. Because, hey, if he had a daughter and she supposedly passed and then it's been 12 years, that don't look like no 12-year-old. But she was also able to see Ishiki's death, which makes sense why she's like, yo, when Code tries to use that as a threat. Like, hey, Ishiki, like, fam, I already know he's dead. Relax. The freaky thing is that she described it also as basically being able to jump consciousness. Like, she's able to send her consciousness to those essential cameras when she's seeing things. And she can't see things from before she was born, but she could see things in the past as well. So, like, that is really, really scary. Basically, like, let's just say she's been around for 12 years. Like, she could see damn near everything. And I said this in my spoiler video, but she could see when Boruto was born. She could see a conversation Boruto had with Kawaki. She could see everything of what happened up until this point. So, yeah, as far as, because knowledge is very powerful, and that's, you know, how you are able to come up with plans and strategies and know everyone's weaknesses and things like that. Like, she'd give a laxative to Naruto and know, like, yo, he can't sustain himself when he has a shitting problem. So, yeah, like, this is strong. And I keep thinking about that damn Naruto episode of him having to take a dump, like... But I noticed that the authors added a little bit of plot protection of her saying, don't ask how many years back I can go. So basically, that's going to be left ambiguous of, like, because Code is like, well, I'd imagine it'd be up until, you know, the birth. But it could only be 5 years. It could be 1 year. Who knows how far back she could go with it. But yeah, I think they did that as, like, plot protection. Because if she would have said, like, 20 years, let's just say, I can only go back 20 years, then there would be like, well, oh, we could point this out and put, you know, plot holes all over the place. So the fact that they left it like a blank canvas this, yeah, kind of could be later on, like, well, oh, she could only go 3 years if a plot hole does appear. And she informs Code of things, again, that we already know, of, like, Amado is the only one that can basically lift the limiters, and it's basically due to, like, a voice and an eye command, and then something where I didn't realize that, unless she's lying, that Amado is damn near Dr. Jiro himself, because she's like, yo, he got remodeled eyes with, like, you know, ninja tech in them. So basically, kind of reminds me of, like, Dr. Jiro walking around with a brain in his head, you know, the artificial brain and shit like that. I didn't know Amado's walking around with ninja tech eyes. That really makes him more of a threat than even before, because I thought he was just a normal human being. The fact that he has modified eyes, this guy could just do an eye beam through somebody. Like, Sasuke could be running, he could be like, oh, it's gonna mess up the plan, he could blast through Sasuke. We don't know what those eyes are capable of. His whole body, for that matter, could be artificial, and he could be really freaking strong and have been playing possum this whole time of, I'm just this old man, now that we know about his eyes. I mean, he could even have Sharingan, Rinnegan, all sorts of shit. And then Ada reveals that she wants to kill Amado, partially because Code starts guessing, she like partially because of his tampering with her and modifying her body, but she has other reasons, because she says with her technique that everyone can fall in love, you know, man, woman, things like that, which we'll talk about the, you know, things that are off limits in a second, but you know, anybody could basically fall in love with her, and that's the problem why she wants to kill Amado, the fact that she will never be able to experience true love, because she's always going to be second guessing, like, wait, is it that they like me and love me because of my ability, like I made them? So it kind of destroyed the idea of romance in her mind. So that's one of the main reasons why she wants to kill Amado, because she feels like she'll never be able to feel true love due to that ability. And apparently Bug is in love with her, and Boro was in love with her too, which I can't imagine Boro being in love. Like, yo, the anime is gonna have a field day with setting all these things up. I can almost guarantee the anime is going to do a lot of in canon filler or anime only, whatever the heck you call it nowadays. Well, anime canon, I'm sorry, they're probably gonna do a lot of that with Boro and Ada. But we find out the weakness to the clairvoyance in terms of like people that can't be affected is Otsutsuki and relatives. More add to the fact that, yeah, Amado put that in there because he's her father, and he's like, yo, I'm not trying to have that. But also that could stem to other things, because again, if let's just say Amado is her father and there's other siblings out there, it could also lead to like certain people not being affected by her ability because of that as well. And the Otsutsuki thing was because of Ishiki, which again really just puzzled me. So like, wait a minute, you was really trying to stop Ishiki, but you put in the two limiters on her of, you know, relatives and Otsutsuki, when it would have benefit you to have like Ishiki fall in love with her, and then she could have just been like, no, you know, stop the tree shit, just come love me. So I mean, I get it, he was on your back, but that would have helped you. Like, there's just so many times where it's like, well, Amado could have done this to stop Ishiki, or at least attempted, like, so he's creating these concoctions of drugs and he had time to do that, but he didn't have time to put in the command of like, yeah, get the Otsutsuki as well, fam. But that also sets up the idea, because Ada's like, oh shit, you know, I've seen this Kawaki guy and the way he tricked Ishiki, and the fact that he's partially Otsutsuki is going to benefit. So she's looking at him as a possible romance subject, Boruto as well, but because she's partnering up with Code now, she's like, yeah, you're gonna need a sacrifice, and I don't need two men, I'm monogamous, so I'll take the one, fam, please. Which I do think that they're going to play around with that a little bit, especially the fact that Sumire likes Boruto in the manga at the very least, and the whole Sarada Boruto thing. Like, they're gonna play around with Ada being like, you know, part of this whole romance thing, because the manga does like to play around with romance a bit. And the chapter ends off with Ada saying that she can see the Kage summit happening now, and they'll never be able to catch them, and they do a toast, and that's the end of the chapter. And honestly, this was one of the most informative chapters, big setup chapters. It didn't feel boring because of the way it was structured. It just felt like straight up, like, here we go, a lot of things are about to go down. And from what I heard, I think there's like only two chapters left until like a whole volume of Boruto is wrapped up, hopefully. And I wouldn't be surprised if these are the last few setup chapters of whatever, if there's going to be a time skip or whatnot. Maybe they're going to be put on ice, maybe Ada's going to go back to sleep for a bit in between all these things, something there. But yeah, that was a little thought. I'm very curious what you guys think about all of this. Ada's abilities, what do you think? Is she Amado's daughter? What the hell is Amado doing at this point? Did he create this whole thing, Kara, and work together with Ishiki to heal his daughter that supposedly died 12 years ago? Do you think Naruto would be able to put down his son? I mean, granted, he said, yeah, Sasuke will do it after saying, you know, I'm the Hokage. And your thoughts on everything, predictions for Boruto chapter 58 and beyond. Like, wow, this was a long one, but we needed to talk. But that's all I have for this one. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed. If you liked anything I had to say or enjoyed the video, drop me a like. I'd greatly appreciate it. And if you want more from me, make sure to subscribe. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram. Hit that bell to get all notifications. And if you want to follow any of my other social media, links in the description below. I'm from the world, and as always, people, have an awesome day.
And remember the golden rule.
Anime and manga.
For life, boy.
Have an awesome day. Peace in. And yeah, Ada, stunning.